everyone hear me? Welcome to my talk about hardening Kubernetes by securing pods. So, oh, okay, yeah, sure. Yeah. Can you hear me now? Is this okay? Hi, everyone. Welcome to my talk about hardening Kubernetes by securing pods. I'm Suraj Deshmukh. I work for a company called Kinfolk. We do a lot of Kubernetes work, like consulting around Kubernetes, writing code for controllers, operators, and things like that. So that's my Twitter and website. I write mainly about Kubernetes and things around it. So a quick show of hands, how many of you have utilized Kubernetes or done something with kubectl? Okay. Lot of folks. Okay, I'll quickly skim through the initial introduction of what Kubernetes is, just so that people who are not on board are onboarded. So it's a container orchestration system, and started by Google based on their internal project called Bog. Which they use for everything, all the VMs, applications, everything run on Bog as a container. And so based on their experience and knowledge, they started this open source project to write when the Docker project was started as well. It has very robust API system. Everything is highly declarative. You can talk to any API, just define a YAML and push it to the cluster, and then it tries to regain that state of the cluster. The workloads run as pod. We'll see what pod is in a bit. And all the configuration, all the information of the cluster is stored in etcd. Etcd is a key value pair database storage. It's a clustered software. So just a quick rundown of all the distributed components that form a Kubernetes cluster. So this is taken from the Kubernetes docs. So here on the left, you can see all the things that form a Kubernetes master. So it's a master worker architecture. So master has API server, which is like a gateway. Everything goes through it. Everyone, like all the components, talk to API server, and API server does the delegation of work. There is kube scheduler, which will schedule the workload as you create something, any configuration, a pod or something like that, it will be scheduled on one of the nodes depending on various factors. There is controller manager, like Kubernetes comes with default set of controllers, like for depending on what kind of workload you are running. Like if it's a batch processing, then it will do like end job. If there is a server kind of workload, it will keep it running all the time and things like that. So that's controller manager. You see etcd, and then there is and every node has a daemon called kubelet. So kubelet is basically is responsible for taking care of starting workloads, talking to API server, and things like that. So for this talk, I is very much close to pod, or very that's why I'll talk more about what pods are just a bit. So pods are basically a set of containers which are always scheduled together on any node. Like they'll always be running on a single node. Like there won't be a case where pods are running on containers are running on different node that form a pod. They share network namespace and they also allow to share a volume. So like here you can see in the image that here on the right there is a web server. It's serving the web content continuously. Now the other container is file puller. So and they're sharing this common volume here. So what's happening is web server is continuously sharing the content from a static volume, and file puller is basically pulling the latest content from a Git repo. So that's how this pod is always serving the latest content. Now you might ask like, why have a different container? They could be in a one container as well. But then the life cycle of one container doesn't depend on the other. Like you could have your custom file puller application and web server could be Nginx. So like that. So we'll quickly see how a pod config looks like. So here you see a pod configuration. It's like everything in Kubernetes, you'll see a lot of YAMLs in this presentation. So here you can see there are two containers. One is the web server Nginx you saw before. And then there is the file puller app. So web server Nginx is basically has a volume mounted at this path. And the file puller is another application which is mounting volume at the slash data path. So what's happening here is the file puller is dumping the data into slash data and the Nginx container automatically gets that data at the mount path word www app static. And they are using a kind of volume called MTDIR. So MTDIR is a type of volume in Kubernetes. Kubernetes supports multiple volume types. MTDIR is one of them. So it's not a persistent storage. Its life is very much attached to this pod. So if the pod goes down, this volume is deleted. So you use this kind of volume only when you want to share content across multiple containers. So now let's get back to the presentation. So let's start with the threat models in the Kubernetes. Like there are external attacks, like you saw, there are multiple web servers running. There is API server, the kubelets are exposing on some port. So they all form a kind of attack vector that an attacker can try to exploit. Like in few releases before, there were few ports that were left open, like where you can scrape the configurations from for CAdvisor and things like that. So that could be one of the attack vector. Then there is compromised containers or nodes or attack from inside. This is what we'll be focusing on. I'll detail on it in a bit. Then there is compromised credentials where you just put the configs on GitHub and then everyone gets access to it. And the last one is misuse of legitimate privileges, as in the RBAC policies are defined in such a way that users is just wide open and anybody can do anything on the cluster. So like I said, we'll talk about what the attack from inside is. So attack from inside. Basically, what you could say is that Suraj, we trust our developers and we allow them to do whatever they want. We don't want to restrict them. But that's a good thing to do. But without checks in place, there could be misconfiguration submitted to the cluster, and something can fall through cracks. So for such cases, you need checks in place where even if you trust your developers and allow them to do stuff, you still put a check where something is red flag, then it is brought to notice, or in other situation where you could say that there is a you developers are using some open source tool or library that is not properly audited, or and a new vulnerability is found, and then you'll be surprised with the news. So another form where attack from inside can happen is, let's say you are hosting a multi-tenant Kubernetes where multiple people or multiple clients are sharing nodes across. Now, there could be a situation where a legitimate looking client is trying to do some malicious stuff, like try to get access, break out of the container, gain access of the node, And once they are on the node, they can basically, since multiple people, multiple pods are sharing the same nodes, the secrets can be exposed to others as well. Now, the secrets could be AWS credentials, like RDS credentials specifically. So yeah, these are various forms of internal attacks. Let's see what the state of container and Kubernetes security is like currently. So this is the OWASP definition of what a secure defaults is. Like it says that out of the box experience of any software should be secure by default. And then Kubernetes, and then users could be allowed to basically opt out of it. Like so basically they are allowed to screw up themselves, but you give what is secure by default. So so what has happened throughout the life cycle of Kubernetes development is like the project started and there were multiple aspects of it. Like Kubernetes is highly configurable. You define YAMLs and configurations and things like that. So the configurations that were, or the default flags that were defined earlier were not secure enough. Like those security things are put in place now, but not everyone is updating with the newest thing, because now somebody has developed application thinking those defaults won't change, or since those are defaults. Now making change to any default is basically a change that will affect everyone. It will be a breaking change for users. So these secure defaults are now not default but opt-in for user. So this is the problem. Also, not user namespace is a very new thing. Not everyone is using it. It will allow people to be secured. Also, a lot of people are running root inside container. That's a huge no-no. And things are basically not secure by default. Like people have to opt in now. So let's dive deeper into what's UID 0 inside container or root inside container. So basically, if you reckon this is a Docker file. This is how you build a Docker container. Basically, you start from the base image. Like here, it says Fedora 30, and this process that starts in this container is slip. Like it will just slip. It won't do anything. Now the difference between the right and the left container image is that the slip process that starts in the left side, it will start as UID 0 or it will start as root. And the one on the right will start as UID 1000, or it's basically non-root or has less permissions. So Dan Walsh, the SE Linux guy, likes to say containers don't contain, and which is kind of true, because containers or Docker containers specifically, if you talk about, they are just using bunch of Linux kernel technologies to try to contain various aspects of thing into itself. Like the PID namespace will try to contain the processes. The user namespace will try to contain the user. So it's not like VMs. VMs are actual sandboxes, or because they come with their own kernel and things like that. So to compromise the VM, it's kind of hard. Like because you have to find a vulnerability at the hardware level, and for containers, you just find a kernel vulnerability, and then it goes for toss. I mean, you might say that the hardware vulnerabilities are now higher, because now, like every few months we see a new hardware vulnerability. But because statistically speaking, still kernel vulnerabilities are more. So, talking about the recent vulnerability in the Kubernetes space, like how many of you know about RunC? Okay, so RunC is basically a lightweight container runtime, which this RunC project came out of Docker. They basically abstracted this whole code that is the container runtime behind Docker, and then they donated it to the CNCF, and then from that implementation, they created a spec called Open Container Initiative. Now, anybody who adheres to Open Container Initiative is RunC is one of them, and it is used by Docker, it is used by Creo, and so majority of the container space has RunC. This vulnerability, what happened was, if you are root inside the container in that Docker container or this RunC container, you could basically just switch the run C binary to whatever you like and then gain access to the host. So this was a major vulnerability, and the basic fix to this vulnerability was if you are not root inside the container, you're basically saved. But talking about root inside container, what I did, I did a survey that if you go to the Docker Hub marketplace, you see a bunch of applications that are widely used, like frameworks, like Kafka, and other messaging services, and web servers, and things like that. So the official images of this these applications, out of this I think 80 applications, only 82% of them are using root, and only 17 are using non-root. What that means is the example that we saw earlier, only 17% of the official images, which are like the widely used images, only 17% define some user which is not root in there. So it's a really bad situation, because if the official images are like not providing you secure by default things, obviously users won't take a effort, right? Because they have to just consume and deliver applications within time, within deadlines. So that's the situation right now. So what could be a solution to enforce root inside the container? So that's where pod security policies come in. So pod security policy is basically a configuration that you define in the Kubernetes. It's a cluster-wide configuration. Like, there are two types of configuration, Kubernetes, like a namespace level and one at a container cluster level. So it enables you to do a fine-grained authorization of pod while creation or while updating the pod. So so it basically, you can define what UIDs are allowed inside a particular container, or what file system groups are allowed, and what capabilities you can allow to that particular container, things like that. So let's see how a pod security policy looks like. So what I have here is there are two clusters. One is with the both are having three nodes, and the upper one that you see has pod security policy enabled, and the lower one you see it has no pod security policy in the cluster. Like you have to boot the cluster with pod security policy enablement. That's why I have two clusters. Now up there, you, like down here, you see it doesn't have anything, and here you see a pod security policy defined called restricted. It's called restricted because a lot of things in there are it's kind of strict one. So yeah, let's see the YAML in a bit. So here you see that this particular pod security policy, it has in these annotations defined seccomp. So if you don't know what seccomp is, using seccomp profiles, you can define what a particular process, like if you bind a seccomp profile to a process, it is allowed to do certain syscalls or it is not allowed, like you can define. With Docker comes with default seccomp profiles, which has like a bunch of things which you cannot do things that will allow you to gain access to the host and do things, do nasty stuff on it. So here in this pod security policy, I have said that use the defaults profile. You can also have other profiles as well. Down here you can see that there is FS group information, and you see the allow privilege escalation is false. What that means is user with this pod security policy, user cannot start a pod with privileged access, like cannot share the host names, host namespaces. Like normally when you do Docker run, you could also do --- privileged and share the host namespace or network namespace. With this pod security policy enabled on particular pod, if a pod is requesting it, it won't be allowed. You see following capabilities are asked to be dropped, like these capabilities, if a container tries to gain, it won't be allowed. Also, this run as user configuration, as in when the container starts inside the pod, it should be non-root. It cannot be UID 0. And it also lists the number of volumes. Like I said before, Kubernetes has multiple volumes. So these are some of the volumes which are whitelisted. Like only these volumes are allowed in the pod that will start. So what we'll do is we'll start containers, start a deployment here. So I'll just try to show like what happens when you run this command. So basically, it's trying to start an Nginx pod with name web, and it's dry run because it just want to show like what happens here. So it's creating this specification like there is one container with one replica, and then the image is Nginx. It's called web, and let's create it probably. Goes and creates. So now here in the cluster which has no PSP, I'll just go and run this command, and it has created that deployment. And when it says that it's container creating, what it means is that the pod request has been accepted, and now it's going to form the pod and it will pull the image and things like that. Up in the cluster which has PSP enabled, I ran the same command. There also it says deployment created. And if you see the pods, it says create container configurator. So what that means is that the pod request is not allowed, or it's still waiting. So let's see what's wrong with this particular pod. In Kubernetes, like I said, you can see any YAML, any resource, it has a YAML associated with it. So pods has this field called container status. And if you see it says that the container has run as non-root image. So what we did was we started the Nginx image, right? It is the default image that is pulled from Docker Hub. And here you see that since it doesn't have a non-root user defined in it, and in the policy we said that must run as non-root. That means it should start as something that's not zero, that's not UID zero. So here it clearly starts at UID zero. That's why this image will not run. So Kubernetes blocked it, or this pod security policy blocked it for us. And to find out what all the configs in the pod security policy we saw earlier are now added to this particular thing, because if you saw earlier in the dry run, the spec was very small, but now the spec has grown because all this configuration was augmented into the request that went to the API server. So you can see those capabilities are dropped here, like the kill mknod and set gid uid are all dropped. Also, the must run as root is true. That's why this is a conflicting thing that Kubernetes found, and then it blocked the request. So, just to see whether which you can have multiple pod security policies in the cluster enabled, to see which one rejected this request or which one accepted this request, it's shown in the annotation. Now, let's see what happened on the cluster, which is basically. So basically, this didn't go through this request, and pod security policy helped us stop it. So yeah, going back to the, I have one more demo, which is not everyone or not anyone will not someone in their sane mind will do it. This is like doing RMRF from the container, from the pod that you are running. So let's see what it is. So like before, I have two clusters. One is with PSP and another is without PSP. And so this both the clusters have one master and two worker nodes running there. So what I'll do is now, this is a deployment config file which I'll run, and I'll try to mount the root of the node, like wherever this pod is running, its root, like you see the slash. It will be mounted inside the container, or inside the container of the pod at slash host path. So I can go inside that host path and see stuff. So let's see. I'll create the configuration in both the clusters. The deployment is created in this thing first cluster, in the PSP cluster, and also in the no PSP cluster. So if you see the pod started in the no PSP cluster. It said container creating, like I said earlier, the container creating, that means the pod request went through, and now the image will be pulled and pod will be started. But in the cluster with PSP, it didn't start. So let's see what's going on. So those who are familiar with Kubernetes, they know like when you create a deployment, it creates another config called replica set. And in replica set takes care of starting those pods. If you see the desired is one and current is zero, that means there is only one. I mean, it didn't reach the state it wanted to. So again, looking at the YAML, it shows that in the conditions, if you see that the host path volumes are not allowed to be used, while we were asking for the host path volume. Basically, all the pod security policies in this cluster, none of the policy allows host path, and hence this pod couldn't start with the host path volume. If you remember from before, like we were only allowing these many volumes, the host path is not in this list. That means this request was denied by the Kubernetes cluster. And yeah, that's that. So basically, since you are trying to mount the root of the node, and the pod security policy saved you from doing it, like it is not allowed. But in the cluster with no PSP, the pod is running fine. Now, what I'll try to do is I'll try to do some evil stuff here. And not everyone will do this stupid thing, like mount the entire root of the node inside the container. But like for the sake of demo, like why not? So yeah, let's see. So basically what you saw earlier was here you see the pod is running in a W0 node. Like we have, like I said, there are two nodes, W0 and W1. So I'll exec into this particular pod and go to the slash host path. That means I'll have access to the, so here, like I said before, the slash host path is mounted inside the container, which is root of the node. So let's go in there. And I just to show that the things from the container are shown inside, are seen in the node as well. So here I'm on the node. I have SSH'd into the node, and I'll just go to the root, and I can see that the file that was created from the container is available here now. So yeah, going forward, we'll just try to delete this whole stuff. Basically making this node unavailable from the cluster. Yeah, that doesn't work. RMRF star works. So yeah, deleting this whole thing and all the files that are currently used are won't be deleted. So you see, like before root, now only a few things are available. And here. So yeah, basically, you can see that I exited. It still shows that the pod is running because Kubernetes runs this reconciliation where it will try to talk to the kubelet. If after a certain point, if kubelet doesn't respond, it will Kubernetes API server will declare that node to be unavailable. So here you see I'm trying to exec into the pod again, but it says that no such container. Or it tried to run the nsenter command to bring that shell to bring the container shell to here, but it didn't work. Also inside the host, I don't see there is ls working or when pwd doesn't work. So basically what I did was I basically made this node unavailable in the cluster. Now any user or who has any data on this cluster or on this node basically is will be rescheduled on the another node. To demonstrate, like in the meantime, it didn't happen that the pod deleted pod was deleted and started on another node. I manually deleted the pod, and now it started on another node here. I'll do the same stuff here as well, and basically make the entire node unavailable for the cluster again. So if you have noticed that this is two node cluster, and both the nodes are gone from the cluster now, and basically anyone who is sharing this particular cluster with me will not have any information. Now, anyone who is any attacker who is smart enough won't do such a stupid thing. They'll silently try to gain access of the secrets. So any pod that is scheduled on particular node, it's all the secrets mounted inside the container, inside the pod, are also available on that particular pod. So as an intelligent attacker would try to just gain those secrets, then go to their AWS or whatever other configs they have in there. So this is like, I mean, even though it was a stupid demo, but you know its implications, that it could be really bad. Now, the last thing that you see here is what I tried was, now both the nodes are gone, and the pod is trying to be created, since like Kubernetes tries to bring it up again. You see that it has a bunch of errors that it cannot do it. The API server has still to figure out that the node is not available. So that's a kind of attack that is possible if you don't have a PSP. So just to talk where PSP sits in the whole process, PSP is called admission controller. So any request that comes to the API server, it goes through these three phases. The first phase is the authentication models, whether you are allowed to even talk to this cluster. Once you go beyond that phase, the authorization kicks in, where RBAC and other policies, like whether you're allowed to even create a pod or any other request that you're doing. And then comes the admission controller. So the pod security policy is a mutating admission controller, which what it means is that when like we did a request earlier, you saw the YAML was very small, but then it exploded because using the pod security policy, what this controller did was it added those defaults, like the capabilities are not allowed, you cannot run as root and things like that. And once the request passes through these things, then it is sent to the API server. So what's the state of PSP in general in the Kubernetes space right now? So out of these, I just picked four most used public hostings, and so on Google Cloud, you can see it is allowed, but anything with PSP enabled, it's a beta feature. It's not a GA feature, and any problems with these are not subject to the support. Then on Azure, it is not allowed yet. The Azure's Kubernetes service on Amazon, it was announced like 2 days back on their 1.13 offering. It's a very new PSP enabled by default offering. Red Hat OpenShift Online has a pod security policy enabled by default. Now, how many of you know about Helm or have used Helm? So those who don't know, Helm is basically a packaging application which helps you. Since Kubernetes has a bunch of configurations, right? You cannot give just a huge YAML and say, okay, deploy this thing. And it's not configurable or even comprehensible by a normal user. Helm makes it easier for someone to write a bunch of configuration, package it, distribute it, and install it on your cluster, upgrade applications. So Helm is, there are a bunch of Helm charts. Like for all the default applications, there are Helm charts you'll find on the Helm repo. And every chart that comes in goes through two stages, an incubator stage and then it is graduated to stable. So on the Helm chart repo, if you go out of the all the Helm charts, only 8% have pod security policies defined in them. And in the incubator repo, only 3.6% have pod security policy defined in them. So it's a very small number of charts that support this. And what we can do to improve this state, I think a talk like this or more information about the importance of this awesome feature of pod security policy would be needed, more demos. Also, what I have seen in my experience is that since pod security policy is inhibiting things, like the default things might not work by just enabling this, you will have to carefully roll out this feature, because there might be images that are running as root, or you are doing host path mounting. You'll have to configure those pod security policies only specifically for those applications. So it's a gradual work. So Docker images need work, Helm charts need work, and since these are secure practices, they should be incorporated from day one. Like generally, security is just an afterthought. It's not given an iterative approach. It's like, okay, we need to deploy and let's see if this works. If it does, and it only then deploy or just scrap it, we'll look at it later. And due to this mentality, the security never comes in. The Cindy Blake, who came here for the Kubernetes India Days, she said security should be given an iterative approach and not a waterfall one. So this really resonates with the thought. Kubernetes pod security policy is just one thing or one aspect of the whole security features that Kubernetes allows. You should always do security in layers. So even if one breaks, others will hold on strong. There are other features like network policy. since any attacker who comes or gains access to the container or shell of the container, they won't just do stuff in there. They'll try to talk to other things, try to talk to databases and see if they can pull out some data from there. So network policies sort of help you to restrict that. Secure image building practices like not allowing root inside the image from the building time itself. Audit logging is a Kubernetes feature which, when enabled, you see all the requests. You can configure whether how much of the information you want to be logged, what requests were, what responses were, who did that, and all this trailing you can do later if you meet a problem. Then avoid mounting service accounts. So service accounts is a secret that is mounted in every pod that is started, which basically helps you talk to the API server from within the cluster. If your application doesn't need to talk to API server, you can basically say that no service account. So it's not mounted. And then a user cannot do anything. Attacker cannot do anything if they gain access to the shell. The other thing is RBAC should be very scrutinized, like you don't allow everything to everyone. It's a very powerful feature, and you should be used with caution. Another point is you can use containers that actually contain or which are actually VMs running as pods. So they are not sharing any kernel, they have their own kernel. So you could use Kata containers or kubevert. GVisor is not really a VM, but it starts its own layer of it's a project from Google where the containers don't directly talk to the kernel; they talk to the internal layer, and then those requests go to the kernel. Another one is deny escalating exec. Like pod security policy is one admission controller. This is another admission controller you can enable. So let's say if a container or a infrastructure pod is running as a privileged mode. A user cannot directly go and try to get the shell access. So these are a bunch of things, references, and thanks. I would like to take questions. This one? Which one?
Hi. Thanks for the awesome talk. Just a quick question. Can PSPs be configured cluster-wide policies and also namespace-wide?
Which one? What's PSPs? Yeah, it's a cluster-wide policy. You allow it using role bindings and cluster roles.
Okay. All right. Thanks.
Hi. Ankit here. I just want to know that you have destroless images also. So is that more secure than this way? Because since it does not even have bash in that.
Can you repeat, please?
The destroless images, which are there for our applications, So they don't even have bash in them. So yeah, is it more secure than this way?
The number of security features you have, the better. So just using the scratch images without any bash, without anything, is always good. Yes.
Yeah. Hi. Like you mentioned about. In the Docker Hub, there are around 82.6% images which are having root as their primary user, and there are around 17.6% users images which are not. So, I was just curious, how did you arrive at this stat?
It's not a comprehensive number. I've put those numbers on the GitHub repo as well. It's in the references. So I picked up all the most used frameworks on the Docker Hub marketplace. If I go and do for entire Docker Hub images, it's not possible. It's like there are millions of images there. So it's just most used frameworks on the Docker Hub marketplace, not on the Docker Hub.
Yeah. Hi, Nemo here. How you mentioned you can have multiple PSPs. And how do they interact with each other? If I try to create a pod, is it denied by default?
So basically, you create a cluster role which allows the usage of pod security policy, and then you use a role binding which basically binds it to particular service accounts. So the service accounts who have access to the pods that have service account access, they'll be scrutinized under those pod security policies. Otherwise, you'll get that error that no pod security policy allowed was allowed. So pod won't start. So before enabling it, you have to have those configurations in place, and only then start the cluster with that admission plugin.
Yeah. So one last question, I have seen some containers that you can say still need the privilege mode to run. For example, there are some Docker containers that still need privilege mode. For example, if you can talk about the TensorFlow containers. So if you want to run them, you need the privilege mode. So if I have a cluster-wide policy with this privilege mode, so then what's the workaround for that?
So the workaround is you write pod security policies specifically tailored for those applications and don't allow them to be accessed by other normal containers that don't need that privilege. So you can have multiple pod security policies, right? And you just enable it for that particular TensorFlow application.
So is it like binding to a particular namespace, which is
binding to a service account? Yes.
Okay. Yeah. Thank you.
Question. Was this the last question? Oh, yeah.